The Genius Prince's Guide to Raising a Nation Out of Debt has been on my radar for a little over a year at this point. I've been very excited ever since I learned about the overall premise, and then to hear that there was an anime in the works just had me jumping for joy, because from what I was told by source readers, I've heard nothing but one of my favorite light novels. It's not an isekai, it's not a harem, it's basically failing from success, because you have a very, very talented prince who doesn't want the job, the only one for the job, and would rather be lazy. But because of the plans that, in theory, should fall apart actually succeeding, you have a prince who is destined to just continue winning and winning and winning, being forced with all this. Basically, I mean, who really wants a kingdom on your shoulders? Especially if you've went from probably your whole life be able to do whatever the hell you want because your father's care of the kingdom for you because it's his kingdom, but when either he falls ill or dies or anything like that, it's gonna fall on you. And the fact that you're actually respected by not just like the general soldiers, but the country as a whole, it seems like, or at least your kingdom as a whole, I should say. It's just amazing to watch that take place. Yeah, you can take apart and pick apart the very mediocre CGI that's a part of this episode. I mean, when the opening's like kicking in and they do a spin around the kingdom, that doesn't look good. And they have multiple points pull away in the battle to really show you these like 3D objects kind of like being pushed towards them. But the core thing about this episode was incredible. It's one of those kinds of episodes that you're not going to be busting out laughing. You're not going to be rolling on the floor being like, I need to catch my breath. But it's constantly hilarious without trying to be a joke. I think the best way to explain the humor is when you see something that you know you probably shouldn't laugh at, but it's hard not to because it's happening to someone close to you. It's not like they're breaking their legs, so you're not an asshole for laughing. It's more of, you feel like the friend of the prince. You feel like, oh my god, you know that he doesn't want this. You know that he would rather the army not have moral, basically, high ground, being like, oh my god, we believe in our ruler. We're going to take care of this army. The army wasn't even like the craziest thing ever, especially, I mean, even before seeing the numbers they had, I was like, I mean, I've read all about Alexander the Great. I've read about all these amazing conquerors. I know that just because you have a larger army doesn't mean you're going to win with the right tactics. But then you see how they actually don't have all that much more in terms of support. But based on what's being said, it seems like the other side, despite also having the numbers, seemingly has the better training. And the fact that the formation of just waiting for them to attack you, like basically be a wall, the fact that they were able to push him back after was just great to see, because you're seeing these plans not being like, oh, he's throwing in the towel so obviously. He's making it a mission to make it seem like he's trying, but goddamn, does he not want to continue with these battles. And I think that's what makes this one so great, is that he's actually forced to the battlefield. There's been very similar shows that have come out in recent memory over the past like 2 or 3 years, and really they weren't for me, but I love the idea of like a slow burn fantasy show where there is that political dialogue that's going to be said. You're going to watch him at a table discussing strategy, but you're also forcing this man into the battlefield because he's that successful in his attempts at failure. The fact that they end the episode after like literally cutting the head off the general's body. I mean, I wasn't expecting the type of brutality that they were showing. Like, there's actually blood, there's actually stabbing, and there's decapitation. There's actually brutal killing, despite it not being like the most violent of things out there, but it does show you, like, this is a battlefield where, despite having goofy laughs and these situational jokes, people can die, right? And to have him basically bring up the most ridiculous of ideas of, we're gonna go attack their gold mine, the only spot in their section of the kingdom that's worth any money. Anyone with a brain should say that's a stupid idea. The one valuable place in a kingdom is clearly going to be guarded. You have no intel on it. You're coming off this moral high victory. Everyone should push back. But the fact that they actually were already planning that just makes them re-support, like they support him even more, and then they somehow win at the same time. As you have Amelia's voice actress from ReZero voicing, who's like, kind of seems like the love interest, but at the same time, it's far too early to tell. But the fact that she meows multiple times just because he's like, you know what, meow for me, because that's the only thing that was bright in his day during that entire situation. But Nim, I believe is her name, absolutely love just how she's just so like, I can't even get you out of this one. It just seems like you're too successful at this point. as we have the genius prince just internally freaking the hell out, as externally he's pretty much being like, oh, absolutely, this is my plan all along. Because he can't just say he doesn't want to rule, because then he'll literally, it'll be a coup, right? Like, he'll be thrown out, if not killed. So he has to appear like he's trying, but the fact of the matter is even when he's not trying, he's successful. This is the type of character archetype that you really think about, saying if he actually wanted to be a successful prince, he probably could be the best leader in their generation. Because the fact of the matter is, I've known this guy for one episode, and from what I just saw of him not wanting to win, and the fact that he did win against what should be normally impossible odds, his people love him, his people believe and hold on to every word he says, and even when he's trying to fail, he somehow succeeds. That's the type of refreshing show you like to see in a series like this, right? Because every anime season, you get your isekais, you get your fantasies, and hell, there's even aspects about the show that you can say, oh, it's the same design kingdom, it's a circular, kind of walls around it, you've seen this in every fantasy isekai out there, but this show is the Genius Prince's Guide to Raising a Nation Out of Debt. It's very confident in the fact that even if initially on the aesthetic or the premise, you're going to be like, oh, I've already seen this before. I saw this three seasons ago. As soon as you get done watching, and probably very quickly into the first episode, I mean, I know within 3 to 5 minutes, I was like, yeah, this is clearly different than what I've seen, even though I thought it's probably going to remind me of so-and-so anime or so-and-so light novel. Instead, I came out saying this show is the better version of all the other shows that have come out in recent memory that attempted a similar thing but failed miserably. And I think by not having this one be an isekai, I do think it works to its advantage, because I love the isekai medium. I guess you could call me isekai trash, but this just feels better knowing it's just a guy who was raised in a kingdom, who didn't want the throne, and now is forced because his father is very ill. And I love seeing him squirm internally as, on his outside appearance, everyone thinks he has his shit together when we all know he doesn't. The opening was not like visually outstanding, but I did like listening to it, so I'll probably keep listening to it every time I watch an episode. And honestly, I think between the two, the ending was the one that I enjoyed the most, but that's just me. We didn't really get too much of a taste of the OST in this episode. It was mostly just the exaggerated voice acting. They perfectly casted the prince, I have to say. I mean, it's nice hearing Amelia's voice actress with who is probably like his childhood friend slash maybe potential love interest or just someone who's going to be around a lot. But I think the prince is the perfect choice. He's not overly arrogant or he's overly cowardly. He's someone who you can see why they believe in what he's saying, because he says it so confidently. But when he's breaking in his mind and screaming in agony, it's hard not to get a chuckle out of what he's saying. It's not trying to be slapstick comedy. It's not trying to be overly violent. It's not trying to be overly anything you've really seen. It's just trying to be confident in the type of almost slow burn kind of like exploration of a successful kingdom who really shouldn't be successful. They're the smallest out of the entire country with nothing to offer in trade, but now they have a gold mining company that they took somehow that really shouldn't have happened. I'm excited for more of this one. I think this is going to be a good watch. I don't think it's going to be the biggest show of the season, but I think from what I've heard of source readers saying, I mean, one of their favorite light novels, and this story is really good, I do think it's going to have a good following in the anime community. And I think by the time this one wraps up, I think a lot of people are going to come back to this one being like, I really shouldn't have slept on this one. This one's actually refreshing for once. But let me know your thoughts, feelings down below, your favorite moment, and what do you hope to see in episode 2 next week? Leave a like if you enjoyed, and subscribe if you're new around here. So until next time, everyone, please take care and have a good one.